We welcome you here today. We welcome you to the people that are here in the Citadel, the people that are on Facebook, and later on YouTube also. It's a beautiful day outside. It's a beautiful day in here. I see we have some visitors. I understand we have a trombonist here and another player. So we look forward to you guys coming and joining us on Thursday, I hope. And then stay with us. Of course, you can always move down here and stay with us permanently. It's fine too. So welcome. Welcome to the court. Just a couple of notes here. One is Bible study is still being done at 12 o'clock on Wednesdays. And it's titled Behold the Lamb. Is that correct? Behold the Lamb. So bring your brown bags with you. Have lunch with us and we'll praise the Lord together. One thing we need to talk about is Easter Sunday services. The thought was that we'd have services and then breakfast following. There's two ways we can do it. One, we can cook it ourselves as we normally do. Or the suggestion is also out there that we could just have it catered at about $10 per plate. So please let us know some feedback on that and we can make some decisions one way or another. As you all know, Major Ron Draper was promoted to glory not long ago. I just want to remind you we have a celebration of life service for him on March the 20th, on a Saturday. At 10 o'clock, the family will receive guests in the teen room, and 11 o'clock, there will be services in the chapel. Yeah, I think that aligns up. One other thing on the tithes and offering, if you'd like to have tithes or offering with us, there is a plate on the way on the out. So just drop it in there. We don't go through the auditorium. And welcome back.
It began with darkness. On the third day, he His light pierced the shadows. His power shook the earth. The Son of God rose, declaring victory over death and throwing wide the gates of heaven. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. His love still calls to us. His grace still covers us. This is the gospel. This is the good news of Christ.
For our first song this morning, we're going to sing from the songbook, song number 214, if you have your songbook, or you can follow along on the screen. This was one of my favorite songs many years ago when I was just a teen in the what we called YPL in those days. Many of you will remember that. Well, if you look at this first verse, you'll wonder why we sang it in YPL and why it was used to be in the youth songbook. It says, years I spent in vanity and pride. Well, when I was a teen, I hadn't spent years in anything. I wasn't old enough. But this was in our youth songbook, and it was one of our favorite songs that we liked to sing. I think because the tune was easy to sing, and it was easy to harmonize to, but we liked to sing this song. So this morning we're going to sing, we'll sing two verses together, we'll give the band a break, and then we'll sing the last two verses. So we'll be led with an introduction by the band. I hope that's your testimony today. Let's sing on the third and fourth verses.
Now I give to Jesus everything. Now I gladly own him as my King. Now my rapture soul can only sing of
so from liberty that comes. manager, Christine, for that as well. I concur. That was one of our favorite songs too, is Young People. At Calvary. I was just thinking about, and I can't remember, it was Tony Campolo who said in one of his messages at one time that he witnessed the testimony of a little girl, couldn't have been more than 9 or 10 years old, who, as she started her testimony, said, "I have been a sinner for years." And it sort of belied her age, but it was quite humorous at the time. I'm always amazed that after all these years, 2,000 plus years, that we as believers are still recreating the story of Jesus. You saw it in our call to worship this morning. You would think that after 2,000 years, we would have forgotten the story of Jesus, but it is so relevant to our lives and to the lives of our family members. And I'm glad that we still carry on these type of traditions where believers gather together on the first day of the week. In case you didn't know, we gather on the first day. The early church gathered on the Sabbath to worship. It would be Saturday, but because of the resurrection of Christ, we come, at least the early church decided that we would come and worship on a day like this. So here we are. And we have the opportunity to come boldly before the throne of grace. And I know that that's a terminology that could be misused, but in this case, it is absolutely true. And many of you are experiencing problems, difficulties, issues, or you have family members who are at this time. And as we have been doing in the last couple of weeks, I like to give you the opportunity to come and represent those issues or those people in your life that you're praying for. I'm rather reluctant to open it up and say, this is what we are going to pray for, only because in many cases it can be very, very private, and I want to respect that. But we're going to have a time of prayer this morning. I wonder, Major Christie, did she leave already? Could we just sing that chorus, "Lord, Make Calvary Real to Me"? And I know it wasn't planned, and I happen to do this every once in a while. I'm sorry. "Lord, Make Calvary Real to Me." And as we sing that chorus, if you would like to come and represent those prayer issues, people that you are praying for, to come forward. You may want to kneel. You may want to stand, or you may want to stand where you are so that we take advantage of the mercy seat, place where we can meet with God, and we can bring these matters, our petitions to Him, or maybe you simply want to say thank you to God today. "Lord, Make Calvary Real to Me," and you come for this time of prayer together. "Lord, Make Calvary time. We don't need to sing it. We're going to listen to it. And again, I would encourage you to come forward for prayer this morning as you bring these petitions to the Lord. Thank you, Major. Thank you. Jesus, we, your children, come before you this morning with thanksgiving in our hearts and praises in our voice. We know our purpose today is to lift our worship to you. We are grateful as we walk through this season of Lent, reminding us of your great sacrifice for us, that your Spirit speaks to us and we get to share in the suffering of Christ. And we also share in the blessings of Christ. We come before you this morning with a variety of needs, a variety of issues that we are concerned about. And we thank you because we believe that you always answer prayer. Even no is an answer. And we bring them before you, some kneeling, some standing, some sitting where they are. They are all consciously speaking to you this morning, asking for your help, because we need your help. I would ask, Father, that today that the meeting outline, the songs we sing, that the scripture that is read and explained would have great relevance to who we are and where we are today in our life. And that it doesn't matter how old or how young, the Spirit will speak to our heart and draw us close to you. It will bring comfort and a sense of calmness, making things right. Can't solve it all, Lord, but we know that you can. You are the answer. And right now we place our trust and our hope in you. And we ask your Spirit to draw us close as we spend this time in worship. This is our prayer as we pray it in Jesus' name.
Scripture portion this morning that is taken from the book of Romans, the 5th chapter, if you'd like to follow along in your Bible. Now, whenever I read one of the Pauline epistles, I kind of arm myself, because even though Paul, I believe, was a very intelligent man, he packed a lot of words in the sentences, or either the translators packed a lot of words for him trying to do that, and I have a tendency sometimes to read a portion and say, huh? What did I just read? And so I asked the colonel this morning if I could read his scripture out of the New Living Translation. So you may not be able to follow along quite as well in your translation, but the sentence structure is a little bit more so that at least I can read it and think, okay, I think I know what he was saying. I also like when I'm reading scripture to make sure that you know what came before that, especially when the scripture starts out with the word therefore. You know, I want to know, as the old timers used to say, what it's there for. So in the book of Romans, he starts out with talking about the difference between man's sinful nature and God's righteousness, and about how God has prepared for all of that and with the law and that sort of thing. But it also talks about God's faithfulness and about man's inability to be righteous on his own. And then it brings in the illustration. God gives a wonderful illustration of Abraham, who was justified by faith. And so we come to the portion that we're going to read today. It's taken from the 5th chapter, and the heading in my Bible says peace and hope. And the one in the Living Bible says faith brings hope. I think both of those are appropriate. So we will begin reading at the first verse. Therefore, since we have been made right in God's sight by faith,
We have peace with God because of what Jesus Christ our Lord has done for us. Because of our faith, Christ has brought us into this place of undeserved privilege where we now stand. And we confidently and joyfully look forward to sharing God's glory. We can rejoice too when we run into problems and trials, for we know that they help us develop endurance. And endurance develops strength of character. And character strengthens our confident hope of salvation. And this hope will not lead to disappointment, for we know how dearly God loves us because he has given us the Holy Spirit to fill our hearts with his love. When we were utterly helpless, Christ came at just the right time and died for us sinners. Now, most people would not be willing to die for an upright person, though someone might perhaps be willing to die for a person that is especially good. But God showed his great love for us by sending Christ to die for us while we were still sinners. And since we have been made right in God's sight by the blood of Christ, he will certainly save us from God's condemnation. For since our friendship with God was restored by the death of his Son, while we were still his enemies, we will certainly be saved through the life of his Son. So now we can rejoice in our wonderful new relationship with God, because our Lord Jesus Christ has made us friends of God. May he bless to our hearts this morning the reading of his word.
We're going to join together and sing a wonderful song. And can it be that I should gain an interest in the Savior's blood? Died he for me who caused his pain, for me who him to death pursued. And it goes, amazing love. How can it be that thou, my God, shouldst die for me? What amazing love that was. He died on the cross for us so that we could live a holy life with him. Shall we have an introduction? And then we will sing.
Amen. Suddenly it started showing up on every special program we had. And I had to tell them, not this time. I was thinking they were all hoping this may be the day. But it's still one of my favorite songs, and you get to that line, it says, "My chains fell off. My heart was free. I rose, went forth to follow thee. And because of that, I surrender all." Now I've standing next to me here is Major Dan Turner. He's been my friend for many years, my classmate at college, and my basketball teammate.
Yeah.
A couple years ago, he had a major stroke, and and to change some things, but God has been good. And today, he and I would like to offer our tribute and praise to God, singing, I Surrender All.
Thank you, Major Dan, for that. Bless our hearts. I think we're witnesses of miracles. And Artith, you did such a good job, and you are absolutely right about the Apostle Paul. Of course, part of it is the translations. I mean, if you read this in the King James Version, good luck. It's difficult, especially that one portion that talks about the inner civil war in his life. Do you know the part I'm talking about? That which I wish to do, I do not do, and that which I do not wish to do, I do. That's a very difficult portion to read in that type of English. And so that's why we have some wonderful translations today that help us. And I do like the New Living Translation. It is a translation, not a paraphrase. But don't mistake it with the Living Bible. That's a paraphrase. This is a translation. And it's my favorite, the New Living Translation. And even though it's my favorite, I wrote this sermon out of the New International Version today. So go figure what happens with this. I just like to pray and ask God's blessing upon this word. Join me. So, dear Jesus, you know that I've worked pretty hard on this, and it really doesn't matter about my words. It matters about your spirit. And so I pray that there's a cohesive plan here and helps us understand what Paul is saying to the church. It's incredibly important that we do. And so we're going to trust you this morning that you're your Spirit will speak to us and help us to digest this type of information for our good and for our spiritual growth. Hear this prayer as I ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to do a little bit of an expository journey. If Major Nancy, is it Fallball? If she were here today, her core cadets, at least some are here, she would understand this. I'm going to teach you a Swahili word, and it's kind of difficult to say, and maybe you'll say it after me, and that is a journey in Swahili, like I'm packing up and going on a journey, would be, are you ready? Here it is, safari. That's the Swahili word for journey, safari. And so we're going to do a little expository safari today on Romans 5. And you want your Bibles open. And I will tell you that there's just too much to digest in Romans 5, the first 11 verses, for us to do it in one setting. So we're going to have half today and half next Sunday as we... The title of the message really is What We Gain Through the Cross. Now, I have to sort of set some sort of historical context. You have to know this, and you may have heard me say it before, but Paul is writing around 70 to 80 AD. The church is under great persecution. You've got to keep that in your mind as he's talking. The church is now... come together with Jews and Gentiles, and they are one, the people of the way. And they are under great persecution. Everyone that knows somebody who's lost their house. How would you like to lose your house? Everyone knows someone who's lost their lives, probably family members, under great persecution. And so Paul, he's giving his argument to these people of why they should turn their lives over to this Jesus, or how they can do this. But instead of talking about suffering with Christ, because they've already been suffering, he wants to help them understand the benefits that you get from the cross, the benefits you get from Christ dying for you. And these benefits are not simply for them back in 70 AD, but thank God they're for us here in 2021, on March the 7th. Now, the genesis really of this comes from that hymn that was led from Charles and John Wesley. Incidentally, the scholars do not know if Charles or John wrote it. Some say it's Charles because it sort of is his conversion song. And others say, well, the phrasing sounds a whole lot like his brother John. And it really doesn't matter at all, because what we have, of course, is the equivalent of the founder's song in the Salvation Army. And if you go to the Methodist church, in every Methodist hymnal, you're going to find this song. And they probably sing it as often as we do the founder's song, although I don't think they sing it to the tune that we play today, Sagina. But it's great. And I just want to remind you of the first verse. And can it be that I should gain an interest in the Savior's blood? Died he for me who caused his pain, for me who him to death pursued, amazing love. How can it be that thou, my God, shouldst die for me? Now, I've just taken the liberty of paraphrasing it for myself. And this is the way I wrote it. How is it even possible for me, a sinner who caused the death of Christ by my own sin, to be considered a benefactor? Receiving the distribution of benefits, gaining from his death, his horrible, inconceivable sacrifice, his painful and bloody death, his immeasurable and boundless love for me. How incredible. So based on what Christ did for us on Calvary, we're going to take a look this morning at the first three of these benefits for us. And right in verse 1, you're going to find the first one, peace with God. It says, and I'm going to use the NIV here, therefore, since we have been justified by through faith, sounds like one of our doctrines, doesn't it? We have peace with God through the Lord Jesus Christ. It says that some pastors would say, now turn to your neighbor and say, I have peace with God. And I'm not going to ask you to do that. That's always been a little awkward for me to do.
Thank you.
Yeah, you too. I'm sorry to digress. I don't know how many of you know Randy Shogren, or knew Randy Shogren, very stoic Swede. And we would go to these promise keepers, and inevitably, they would want us at some point in the meeting to either hug the man next to us or hold his hand. And I'm German, Randy was Swedish, and I remember us standing next to each other when a request came like that, and Randy put out his little pinky finger, and I joined him with my pinky finger, and there we had such an emotional bond holding the pinky fingers together. Yeah. So here it is, and the peace that I'm speaking, or that Paul, rather, is speaking about, is not the peace between nations. It's not the peace between you and another person. The word that Paul is using is eirene, which simply means to make things right. Now, Paul would think that way because Paul was not a Greek. Although he knew Greek well, he was a Roman citizen. He knew the Roman culture, but he was, what did he call himself? A Pharisee of Pharisees. He was Jewish to the core. And so he would remember Isaiah. I'm certain he probably thought of Isaiah as he said this. He was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was upon him. And by his wounds, we are healed. Now you would know in the Jewish sense that the word peace that Isaiah would use, and I think this is the peace that even Paul is thinking of, that word shalom, which means not only the absence of everything bad, but the presence of everything good. That's what he's meaning. And the peace that we need to be dealt with, and many of us have experienced, is that angst, that inner turmoil within us when things or issues or people are causing us inner stress, because we know our relationship with those things or issues or people are just not in the right order. True confession, and I'm glad we have young people here today. I was a good student in training, in school. I was a good student in school, but I was a lazy student. I was the kid that the counselors will say to their parents, you know, Dennis, he's good, he's smart, but he's just not working up to his potential. Anybody ever hear that? Yeah. Well, that was me. And I remember, you know, I loved school. I loved the challenge. I was in a lot of AP classes, and the problem was that I was smart, but I had no discipline. And inevitably, I would fail to do my assignments that were due that day. And I would show up, and I'm telling you, my stomach is gurgling. I am sweating. I am so anxious because I know I didn't do the work, and I'm trying to finagle away so that the teacher doesn't call on me to give the answers. You know, I wish that that would have taught me to actually prepare, but it never did. So you've experienced that, I'm certain. You know what I'm talking about, that awkward, fearful, what am I going to do now feeling. It's the opposite of calmness. It's the opposite of the sense that everything is okay. And that is the peace that Paul is talking to these people about. And he's talking to us about. Do you want that kind of peace? The kind of peace that Isaiah said, you will keep him in perfect peace, whose mind is stayed on you because he trusts in you. Or as Paul would say to the Corinthian church, for God is not the God of disorder, or some translations, confusion. God is not the God of disorder, but of what? Peace. Oliver Wendell Holmes probably said it the best. What lies behind us and what lies before us are small matters compared to what lies within us. Romans 8, Paul says in another further of this, the mind of a sinful man is death, but the mind controlled by the Spirit is life. Let me just insert here. Paul, he's talking to believers. He's talking to us. The mind that's controlled by the Spirit is life and peace. The sinful man is hostile to God. It does not submit to God's law, nor can it do so. I don't know if any of you have ever been to San Jose, California, and visited the Winchester Mansion. Anybody? This is the... Yeah, okay, a few of you have. All right, good. I never have, but it's very interesting. This is a massive structure built by Sarah Winchester, and she was the widow of the gun company owner, for which we get the word Winchester. For 38 years, from 1884 to her death in 1922, the house was under constant construction. Teams of carpenters, masons, and other workers were employed around the clock. Various stories have been told about the reason for this unusual practice. Most center on Mrs. Winchester's belief that she either was haunted or would be haunted by the ghost of those killed by her husband's weapons unless she kept building her house. Others claim that she thought she would not die as long as she was building this mansion. So whatever the reason, she continued ordering more renovations and constructions as long as she lived. There are more than 10,000 windows in this mansion. How'd you like to clean those? Doorways and stairs that lead to blank walls, and some 160 rooms in total. It's estimated that she spent more than $70 million in today's money, probably more than that, more like $100 million, all in a desperate search for peace that was ultimately doomed to fail. Now, I like the way the Message renders, and this is a paraphrase, Romans 5:1. I'm going to read it to you. By entering through faith into what God has always wanted to do for us, set us right with Him, make us fit for Him, we have it all together with God because of our Master Jesus. Some of us in this room knew Commissioner Stan Dittmer.
Oh, yeah.
And we loved his songs like I'm in His Hands. I did not realize it until I was humming this song. And who wrote this song? It was Stan Dittmer. At Peace with My God. Remember that one? But how could it be except by the love of Jesus for me? Anxiety gone, sins under the blood, and I am at peace. At peace with my God. Oh, we thank Jesus for the crucifixion, because you and I, we can have peace with him. Here's the second gain, or the second benefit. It's in verse 2. It's access to God. Here's verse 2, what it says. Through whom we have gained access by faith into this grace in which we now stand. Right? This is a twofold reference. One, as an Old Testament regulation as to who may have access to God. And we know that in the Old Testament, it was really only the high priest. And if you and I lived in that day, we would be required to come and do the bathing, to actually ascend to Jerusalem, to do the proper washing, cleaning up, the ritual washing, and then to ascend to the hill with our sacrifice for the priest, and the priest would sacrifice, and it was only the priest that had access to God through the Holy of Holies. That's one of the renderings. The other one deals with the division in those days between Jews and Gentiles. And we've talked before about Acts chapter 10, where Peter takes the brave step and he actually goes to a Roman colony, Caesarea Philippi, just up the road from where he was in Joppa, or Yafo, which is modern-day Tel Aviv, going up the road and meeting with a general, a Gentile general who was a man of God. And he broke that barrier between them at that point. And the Gentiles, it didn't get easier for them. I mean, the Jews still were Jewish, and the Gentiles considered goyim, or goy, as the Yiddish would say, which simply means heathen. And the Jews who were steeped in regulation, Levitical law, would insist that they watch what they eat and that they should be circumcised and all those. And then Paul and Peter both argue it out at some point. And it's a wonderful dialogue for us to listen to, because God allows all that stuff in the scriptures to help us understand, hey, these are pretty regular people. They have disagreements too. But here was the chasm in between. Now, Paul says in Ephesians chapter 2, verses 14 to 18, I'm reading it, "For Christ himself has brought peace to us. He united Jews and Gentiles into one people in his own body on the cross. He broke down the wall of hostility that separated us. He did this by ending the system of law with its commandments and regulations. He made peace between Jews and Gentiles by creating in himself one new people from two groups." I think we could all take notice of that today when it comes to any kind of discrimination or racism. Because God has brought us together, we are one people, and it doesn't matter what we look like or our color of our skins. I said over and over and over, racism is a matter of sin. Sin in the heart. Sorry, I got on my own soapbox at that point. Back to Paul to Ephesians. "Together as one body, Christ reconciled both groups to God by means of his death on the cross, and our hostility toward each other was put to death. He brought this good news of peace to you Gentiles who were far away from him, and peace to the Jews who were near. Now all of us can come to the Father through the same Holy Spirit because of what Christ has done for us." The way that the NIV says it, "For through him we both have access." Now, just a question here. How many, by a show of your hands, have been invited into the Oval Office of the White House? Raise your hand. What? Nobody here has been invited into the Oval Office? Well, let me show you someone who was invited to the Oval Office. It's a photo. There we go. I don't know if you can see it. And this is an old photo from about 1962, 1963. All you young people, what is that? That is President John F. Kennedy. And under his desk, remember what they call that desk? The Resolute Desk. There's a little boy. That happens to be John Jr. Both, of course, we know President Kennedy was assassinated. John Jr. lost his life not many years ago in an airplane crash. But here we are. We have a picture of the son of the president in the Oval Office. Now, I only say that because I don't believe John ever had that asked permission to go into his daddy's office. I think he had an open access to that great office and even to the Resolute Desk by relationship, because he was the son of the president. Likewise, you and I, because we are the sons and daughters of God through Jesus Christ, we have amazing access to the Father every day. You and I, we can do that. And that's what Romans 5 is all about. It's the picture of our Father granting us absolute access. And again, I like the way the Message puts it, Romans 5:2. And that's not all. We throw open the doors to God, and we discover at the same moment that he's already thrown open his door to us. It's amazing. God has given us absolute access. Now here's the third benefit. Remember, Paul is talking to these people who have been suffering. And they get this wonderful peace, a calmness that they haven't experienced in a long time. They get this access, and here he talks in verse 3 about a glorious hope. It's at the end of verse 2. And we rejoice in the hope of the glory of God. Peace with God takes care of the past, ladies and gentlemen. He will no longer hold our sins against us. Access to God takes care of the present. We can come to him at any time for help and what we need. But the hope of glory of God, it takes care of the future. One day, we shall share in his glory. For many of our friends, long past, recently past, like Major Draper, and many others that I can think of, they are currently enjoying the presence of his glory. It's merely a promise for you and me. God has accomplished that. Jesus accomplished it for us. And it remains a hope for us based on his promise. And what's his promise? You know it. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God. Trust also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms. And if it were not so, I would have told you. And I am going there to prepare a place for you. And if I go to prepare a place for you, I will come back and I'll take you to be with me, that you also may be where I am. Last Tuesday, as I arrived home, around 6-ish, my wife had a nice little supper ready for me. And I got a text from a soldier at the Hernando County Court. She was telling me about her brother, what's his name? John, brother John. John has been a volunteer for years at the Hernando County Corps, and Lori is a sergeant major. Lori lives in Timber Pines where we do, and John does as well. And she told me that John has been placed in hospice. And I've had many conversations with John. And I said, oh, where's he at? Thinking that he was in some institution. No, he's in hospice in his home. They're coming to his home. So he lives just down the street from us. So we went to see John that night, last Tuesday night. And as we entered, he was sort of comforted by these hoses of oxygen to his nose. He was sitting in his chair. A great big smile broke out on his face when we came in. And we sat and we talked for a while. And you've got to know John. John is he's very stoic. You're a good man. No, don't say that. Don't say that to me. And we talked about his relationship with God some years ago when we thought John was getting ready to go to heaven. And Lori said, I'm not certain he's made his peace with God. And so I went to the hospital at that time and I visited him. And I said, John, your sister said this. I want to make sure that you're right with God when he calls you home. Oh, I'm right with God. And that's about all he would say. But I've made my peace. So when we came in on Tuesday, I said, John, you and I have talked about this. And John's in his 95th year. He's lived a long life. And I said, so what do you think, John? You know, if God, when he calls you home, how you feeling about that? Well, he said, quite frankly, I'm very curious. Very curious, huh, John? Well, your curiosity is going to be satisfied. And you told me you have peace with God. And so I want you to enjoy it. And I want you to rest in him. And we had a wonderful time. I didn't realize that his daughter was there and his son-in-law. And his son-in-law happens to be Jewish. And so I'm not really sure what he thinks of that. But we prayed fervently with John. And I'm still waiting to see what happens. But there was a sense of a real peace that he had, because he's awaiting the hope of the glory of God. Romans 5:2, that last part says it this way. We find ourselves standing where we always hoped we might stand. Out in the wide open spaces of God's grace and glory, standing tall and shouting out his praise. Well, here we are, ladies and gentlemen. That's really it. There are three things I talked about, and you're always supposed to remind everybody what we talked about. Those three benefits, those gains: peace with God, access to God, glorious hope. Paul proclaims them all as a result of the sacrifice of Christ for you and me. As a result, John or Charles, they end that beautiful anthem, no condemnation. Thanks, John, for mentioning it. No condemnation now I dread. Jesus, and all in me is mine, alive in him, the living head, and clothed in righteousness divine. Bold I approach. You can only approach him boldly when you're at peace and you know you have access to him and you have that hope. Bold I approach the eternal throne and claim the crown through Christ my own. What authority. What certainty. It's not a matter of giving today or giving up that we always emphasize. It is what you and I gain through the cross of Jesus Christ. Next week, we'll focus on the remaining gains, but for this moment, we sing together a song, a chorus. It's a chorus I like to use at this time of the year because it reminds us, Lord, make Calvary real to me. And I'd like you to sing that with me. And once again, there's always opportunity for prayer. If you don't have the peace that we've been talking about, boy, you better make it right. If you feel like you haven't had access, there's something wrong between you and God, and you don't have that access, make it right today. Know with certainty that if the Lord were to take you home today, boldly, you could stand before his throne. If not, come this morning for prayer. Sing it with me.
Make Calvary real.
to you. We thank you for your word. We thank you for the Apostle Paul that sometimes is difficult for us to understand. And that's why we depend on your Spirit to speak through the word straight to our heart and our head, and to help us understand what is appropriate and applicable to our lives. So we trust, God, that your Spirit has, is, and will be speaking to us, not only through this time, but as we enjoy fellowship or food wherever we go, that we will think on these things. And we give you glory, and we say thank you, Jesus, for what you did for us at Calvary. Amen.
I was watching again the other night a TV program, and I noticed one of the villains, a very bad guy, had hanging around his neck a little silver cross hanging there. And I think, again, how many people wear that cross they buy somewhere, you know, as a good luck charm or a piece of jewelry, but they do not have the experience. The cross that we celebrate during this season, especially, and the one we've heard about today especially, is not purchased at Jared's or Kay's or any of those places. You'll find it on a hill far away, an old, rugged, ugly cross. And that's what we're going to sing about right now. We don't sing it very much, but here it is, and we're going to sing. I want to read the second verse. I asked Colonel Hope if we could get the first and third verses up there. Here's a second. I don't want to leave it out. Oh, that old rugged cross, so despised by the world, has a wondrous attraction for me. For the dear Lamb of God left his glory above to bear it to dark Calvary. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross. We're going to stand together. We're going to sing two verses together. Not too slow.
On a hill far away, stood an old rugged cross, the emblem of suffering and shame. And I love that old cross, where the dearest and best for a world of lost sinners was slain.
peace with you.